Welcome. Thank you. Welcome to CME 500. I am Margot Gerson. I'm a professor here on campus, and I'm not the organizer of this course, but both organizers are still on vacation. So they said to me, can you do the introduction? So I want to welcome you to CME 500, AI for Good. And it's really a pleasure, also because it is the third seminar that we have had in the series now in ICME. And I will tell you a little bit more about that later, all around AI and what we call hurtling down the data highway, as we have been doing as a society and as a research community as well for quite a few years now. I want to just thank some of the sponsors. I want to thank Google also for providing us with the moderator for today, Scott Pemberty. We'll introduce him a little bit later on. And also our co-sponsors of this seminar series. There's a whole bunch of other partners here on campus that have collaborated. All right, now a little bit about the background of this series. This is sponsored by ICME with some partners, the Institute for Computational and Mathematical Engineering. We started this about 3 years ago. I am the former director of ICME, and when I was still running ICME, we started this thing called a seminar series called Hurtling Down the Data Highway. And then we had AI in real life last year. And then based on student feedback, we decided this year to focus mostly on unintended consequences of AI and really thinking about how AI can be used or not for good. So that is, we're kicking this off, of course, today with this panel session as well. But it was thanks to the feedback of the students, and I just wanted to emphasize this also for those of you taking this class for credit, when the evaluations come at the end of class, do fill those out. They're so useful, and thanks to the evaluations last year, we can now have this year. So for those of you who contributed to that, thank you so much. I think it's extremely important to talk about AI unintended consequences, both positive, by the way, and negative consequences, and really think about what we're doing when we're applying AI and what it can do and what it cannot do and maybe never will be able to do. But we can also dream, and all of these things are so important now because AI is, and data science, of course, just taking off so very quickly. And I see in my profession also so many applications that are interesting and useful and potentially valuable, but also many, many applications where I think, what are they thinking? And maybe this is something we have to be a little bit careful with. So I'm just delighted that today we can start this discussion. And I just want to introduce Scott Pemberty here, who is going to be moderating this panel. And you will be introducing the other two panelists, yes, I take it, right? So it's over to you.
Be ready? So we have 3 hours, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So get your pillows out now. So thank you very much, Margot. So we've got a pretty exciting panel here for you today. A little background about me. I earned a PhD in classical AI back at MIT and University of Washington. And I didn't really believe the neural network stuff either until about 2012. And the, sort of the big bang happened, as we all studied here at Stanford. And I've had the luxury and the privilege of working at Google Cloud the last 4 years. And in that, I have a pretty unique role where I get to dig in deep to Google Brain, DeepMind, and our research, and then talk to the captains of industry. When I talk to her, she'll tell me about where she wants to apply AI and where she sees insights for AI. And I've talked to over 300 CEOs in the last 4 years. And a sea change has happened just in the last 6 months. We'll talk about the impact of AI. It's now being adopted by a number of people. They start to understand neural networks. They're getting less afraid of cloud. And in those discussions, they listen to the technology, and they trust that you all know how to do this. But the first question I'm getting now is like, how do I do that in an ethical way? How do I, the things I want to apply, I want to do good, I want to basically serve more people, like on my suicide hotline, it's an area we granted. How can I serve more customers? But when I do that, how do I avoid unintended consequences? What about data governance? What about the political realm in which I operate? If I do one thing correctly in California, the ethics in California don't apply in Saudi Arabia or vice versa. Can you help me through that? And so we're working with Margot and the team, we wanted to figure out, could we have a public forum for the brightest young minds in here at Stanford and start to have that discussion of how do we bring in the issues of ethics and privacy and bias and work through this and from a first principles perspective. And today we have the privilege of having some really amazing minds with us today. Rob Reich, is how I say it correctly? So he's a leader in thinking about when you actually introduce big giving, when you give away, turns out it becomes a plutocracy. And there's some ill effects of actually allowing individuals to give such gratis into the market. And how do you deal with that from a democracy perspective? And you also, Margot earlier was the director of ICME, but now also doing research. She's looking at things like AI for good in terms of how do you create a gigawatt of clean power? If you have a gigawatt of clean power, 300 to 400 of these windmills, how do you model that? And because and how do you use AI in that technique? And then she's very famous for looking at this on YouTube and saying that the mathematics behind all this is quite beautiful, and that's a new way to be thinking. And then also, Sharad's also helping us on his perspective on the end here, and Sharad's thinking a lot about computational social science and computational policies. In other words, can you start to introduce mathematics and statistics to think about these from first principles to introduce that? So what I'd like to do is sort of hand the mic to each of them to let you see for a couple minutes their perspective, what their backgrounds are, and then we'll get into the discussion. So Rob, you want to start?
Sure. Thank you so much for the invitation to join the panel and the chance to speak with you all today. My background is as a philosopher, so I teach in the political science department. My area is political philosophy. I'm currently the faculty director of the Center for Ethics and Society on campus. I'm working with the new Institute for Human-Centered Artificial Intelligence, HAI, here as well, in trying to build out a whole range of research programming as well as teaching that introduces the consideration of ethical and social dimensions of AI into both research and teaching. In fact, I just left a class that I launched last year. It's offered again this quarter called The Ethics of Technological Disruption, taught with a computer science professor and a public policy professor, in which there are coding assignments, public policy memos, as well as philosophy papers to write. That gives you an idea of the type of collaboration that I'm interested in at the intersection of the topic of technology and ethics. And to give you a little bit of sense of my own sort of rough thinking that I would invite you to think through as well, I think that there are really simplistically three different kinds of ethical questions that arise in general, but also when we think about AI. The first is a set of questions of personal ethics. How can you be a good person, live a good life? And often, sometimes people think that when you introduce ethics into a business school curriculum or a medical school curriculum or an engineering school curriculum, the goal is to inoculate you, the person, against doing really bad things. Or in concrete terms, if you need an example, don't be Elizabeth Holmes. Lying, cheating, stealing your way to business success is not ethical. Now, I consider these to be uninteresting ethical questions. It's not that they're unimportant. It is true that it's bad to lie, cheat, and steal, but there's nothing especially ethically interesting about that view. And if what we need in the curriculum is students to be taught that, I think we already all learned that back in kindergarten. A class on personal ethics that tells you not to do bad things is not all that interesting. All right, so that's first level. Second level is professional ethics. Not personal ethics, but professional ethics. And I'll invite you to think through the university landscape and the social landscape that has arisen in biomedical research as opposed to computer science and AI. In the wake of a variety of scandals in the 1940s and 50s, and then a series of reports that came out in the 50s and 60s, now if you go do biomedical research, if you get a medical degree, you work in a pharmaceutical company, there are professional codes of ethics to which you are held, sometimes just by force of norm and sometimes by law, that you have to adhere to at the risk of being exiled from respectable scientific community. So take, for example, the case of the Chinese scientist who just last week was announced has been sentenced to 3 years in prison in China for having applied the CRISPR gene editing technique to a human embryo. The professional scientific community that came up with this extraordinary scientific innovation, CRISPR genetic editing, created a set of scientific norms, professional ethics, as it were, that said, we will not tolerate experimenting with this particular innovation on human embryos, at least not yet. And then this scientist went ahead and did so. He's disinvited from any scientific conference. No journal will publish anything he has to research. And now, in fact, China has imprisoned him. What equivalent institutional infrastructure is there for AI scientists that would parallel what we see in biomedical research? In biomedical research, we have an institutional review board in which you have to pass your research projects through a filter that includes ethical considerations, the well-being of human subjects. Data scientists have no equivalent of an IRB process. Can you imagine any AI scientist being exiled from respectable AI science community for having engaged in a particular project that people think brought about terrible consequences? If someone has an example, I'd love to know about it. That's a much more interesting set of ethical questions, these questions of professional ethics. And having the kind of experience that happened within biomedical research happen now within engineering schools and AI science, I think would be a worthwhile long-term project for both industry as well as universities. Finally, the most interesting level of ethics is what I want to call political or social ethics. Not questions about personal goodness or badness, not questions about professional ethics, but about what happens when there are powerful technologies that involve making value trade-offs or refereeing tensions between things that are good. If you're an AI scientist, how should you value privacy versus safety? How should you referee predictive accuracy in your machine learning against the values of fairness, privacy, and explainability? What if those can't all be perfectly combined into one approach? Those are questions to which there is no single correct answer. There's no note card to give anyone at the end of a class to say, here's the ethical checklist. If you check all the boxes, you're good to go. We just have standing value tensions to referee in society. And with the rise of the power of AI in general, and of the people who know how to create it, the AI scientists and the tech community that powers it, AI scientists are now extraordinarily powerful social actors making decisions about value trade-offs that affect all of us. And I think the most interesting ethical questions are those that engage all of us together in reasoning through value trade-offs. And I'll try to give you a few examples of those in later discussion.
Thanks, Rob.
Margo?
Thanks, Rob. I think we can all go home now. You summarized that really well. I come into this whole discussion from a slightly different background. I'm a mathematician by training. And about 35 years ago or so, when I started my studies in math, AI was there, but it was a little bit obscure. We're a small number of people doing this. The computing power was not really there to get anywhere with very large data sets. We were collecting lots of data. In fact, I spent most of my life unable to actually digest the data that I'm creating or collecting. And so now, in that sense, this is a really interesting time for me, because now I'm finally finding the tools to go back to data that I collected 20, 30 years ago, and now I can actually see what they meant, which is kind of nice way to midlife in your career. But as a mathematician, I was always interested in accuracy, in robustness, and trustworthiness of computations. That's what we do as a mathematician. We look at things like accuracy and stability and robustness in general terms. And I still look at that in data science and AI in particular now in my field. So my field is the one of predictive simulation. Really like working with fluid flows and simulating physical processes, natural processes, or engineering processes. And we're always interested in making accurate predictions or making accurate simulations of reality that we may or may not be able to actually validate or even verify. And about 10 years ago in my field, the really interesting thing happened is that computer scientists came in, and some statisticians, but mostly computer scientists, say, we can do what you're doing using deep neural networks, or at that time they didn't call them you know, it wasn't called deep learning, but maybe the networks were not so deep yet, but with a couple of layers at the time, is that we can do this and we don't really need to know much about the underlying physics. So by partial differential equations and laws of physics that we had so many beautiful mathematical models for, we can do this without actually knowing that, just based on data. And what I saw is a very rapid adoption of these techniques in some of the areas that I work in, and in companies and also amongst researchers. And with companies, particularly in energy companies, particularly in companies like Boeing and NASA and others, without really them understanding the reliability and trustworthiness. So that is, to me, also an ethical problem. You know, as a mathematician, as a researcher, we really should understand, I think, what we're doing, and really need to be able to stand behind what we're producing and believe in it and be able to explain to others what is happening. So I spent quite a bit of time educating people about this, trying to get them to understand the nitty-gritty of AI and data science algorithms, trying to also explain to them what can be understood and what cannot, you know, what it can do and what it cannot do, and how you may be able to get more faith in these solutions, you know, by very, very clearly and very robustly looking at the algorithms and testing them out in all sorts of different ways. But most of all, what I'm interested in is helping people understand when to use AI and when not. You know, we're in a period right now where AI is used by everybody almost for everything, independent of how much data they have, the quality of the data they have, sometimes independent of the questions really that they want to address, because it is such an interesting, sexy application, right? And I've had people say, I need to use deep neural networks because then my paper will get published. I want to be the first in my research area to use deep neural networks. And when you start asking, but why would you do this? Do you really need this? What are the questions you want to answer? What tools would you really need to answer those questions? Do you need a deep neural network? Do you in fact have enough data? What sort of data would you like to have? With the data that you do have, what sort of algorithms could you use with some reliability? Those are some of the questions I'm really interested in.
Thank you. So you're pointing out, you know, when to use AI, because it's a tool, like any tool. And you're saying when to use it, and when you use it, do you understand what it's actually doing?
Right.
And you had a framework for when you use these things. It's one of the tools in your tool chest. And you got to think through your personal ethics. You got to think through your professional ethics and societal ethics. But I think that's also getting into the things that we also bump into that can also guide us in appropriate uses in society. That gets to public policy. And so maybe, Sharad, you can tell a little bit about your thinking about computational public policy and how you're thinking about this problem.
Yeah, I think this is a really great panel. We have all these different perspectives. And I would say that what I'm maybe bring to this conversation is a lot of my work, and what my lab is doing is designing and deploying algorithms to aid public policy. So let me give you two recent examples of things that we're working on. One we recently deployed in San Francisco. So this is in the prosecutor's office, in the DA's office. So every time someone is arrested in most major cities, a prosecutor has to make a decision about whether or not to charge that individual with the alleged offense. So about 50% of people nationally who are arrested are ultimately charged. If you're not charged, you end up usually spending a couple nights in jail, which is pretty terrible, and then you're released. And for all intents and purposes, it's like it never happened from the justice system's perspective, but you still spent this time in jail. And so these prosecution decisions, these charging decisions, are quite important. And the way that they are happening right now in again, almost all jurisdictions, is prosecutors are reading these narratives that police officers draft and then making a decision up or down on whether or not to proceed. And so this is one of these places where implicit bias can creep in. So you might know the location where an incident happened, you know the race of the individuals involved, all these other things that probably aren't super important to the charging decision itself, but it's very hard to ignore that information when it's presented to you in narrative form. And so what we built is a tool that automatically masks these narratives, these are free, these are just like free text narratives, masks them of race and race-related information. So explicit mentions of race, proxies for race, like hairstyle, names, names of officers, names of, because even the prosecutors know which neighborhoods officers work in, names of the victims, names of the suspects, locations, all of these types of this piece of information that can be used implicitly to create some sort of bias, but it's not really important to make the decision. We try to mask all of that and then present that masked narrative to the prosecutor to make that decision. So now in San Francisco, every felony case is being run through the system. So it's a two-phase system. The first phase, they read the masked narrative, then they make an up or down decision, then they read the unmasked narrative. They can change their mind if they want. They just have to justify why they're changing their mind. And so we're, again, we're preserving all of the evidence that might be helpful in making these types of high stakes decisions, but at the same time anchoring people to make those decisions based on what is arguably most important and try to reduce some of these implicit biases that can creep in. So here, the technical difficulty, there's all sorts of technical difficulties in this. One thing is you're going from a paper-based system, which is how the vast majority of American bureaucracy works, is on paper. The first step was transition the office from paper-based system to a digital system. So that's already a pretty big step. And then once you're in digital form, you can use natural language processing and all these other sort of modern tools to mask narratives. So I mean, something like you have to distinguish between black man and black shoe, that's a pretty easy one. You also have to carry co-references across a narrative, that's a pretty hard one. And so if someone says he over here, you have to know that he refers to this he down here. So that's a pretty hard association to make. So you just have to do these mass narratives. So the second example I'll give is again related to criminal justice. A lot of my work is criminal justice related. Is that when somebody has been charged, and in some cases they're released pending trial, and so then they have to come back to court weeks or even months later, a lot of people don't come back for a variety of reasons. Sometimes they just don't realize the severity, the importance of having to come back. Sometimes they don't have a good way of getting to court. They don't have easy access to transportation. They don't have childcare. They don't have all these other things that often many of us take for granted. And so what we're doing is designing interventions to get resources to people who need them the most to get them to trial. Once you miss trial, all sorts of bad things happen. And people are missing court dates for very, very simple reasons. You know, they live far from a bus line, and so they can't make it to court. So it takes 2 hours to get there when it takes someone with a car, 15 minutes. That's a pretty serious burden. And so what we're doing is we're designing a system to allocate door-to-door rideshare service for people who need to get to court, and then there's a limited budget, so you have to do some optimization problem and figure out who is most likely to succeed with these types of interventions. So that's something that we're rolling out across the country now. So these types of very simple, and in the algorithmic sense, they're very simple interventions, but arguably these could change the lives of tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands of people who are affected by these Byzantine criminal justice systems.
Well, thanks, Sharon. So I think what you've seen so far is we talked initially about the demand we're seeing in the market, and for people like yourself to think through, if you want to do AI for good, how do you think about this, have critical thinking? And we have three sort of frameworks you've seen here, right? So one is sort of an ethical framework and also an economic framework. And how do you deal with, think about that perspective. Then you have also from a foundational framework in terms of, do you understand what these algorithms are doing from a scientific perspective, and where do you actually use the tool? You know, not everything's a nail if you have a hammer. And then third, we have a policy perspective and thinks of, if you're using this, in what way can policy help you in to do the right thing, if you will. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna rattle off a few areas where we're seeing AI for good, very recent into the last few months, that we're genuinely as a market trying to figure out how to use this in a very positive way. And then we're gonna spend a few minutes going through some unintended consequences that these folks have seen and sort of their frameworks for how do you tackle this? You know, is this sort of if you have a good deed, how do you make sure that it follows through and does what you intended? So a couple examples, just after Christmas, I woke up and I read the paper and I found out some of my colleagues at Google had worked together with DeepMind and others and some hospitals. And by looking across a number of doctors, we're able to create an AI technique that was better detecting breast cancer than doctors. Mm-hmm. Just like we've done before with retinopathy caused by diabetes. And that was pretty extraordinary. Last year we put a small fund together and reached out to do AI for good. And the idea was, can we help donate some of that money to help use AI? And I'll show a few of these. One is We had AI to assist low-income students for writing and communication skills. Another one was AI to interpret hand signals. So now those that are deaf can communicate more with others, you know, on video chat, for example. We had AI to detect suicidal behaviors on a call center line to help scale out those that need help most. Because a lot of times, if you're waiting, it's not fast enough. And also conversational AI to help isolation as people age. And as you're aging, you know, instead of just using, you know, reading glasses like I do, you can use AI to help assist visual. Like you're in a situation socially, and you walk up, and it whispers in your ear, "That's Bob. You met Bob 3 weeks ago, right?" How can AI? And these are all efforts that are ongoing today. But if you think through this, what about these issues? I mean, so in other words, what are the things, of all that good that's happened, and there are a lot of people really trying to use AI in a good way, what are the things you think about, Rob, that we need to really pause as we start deploying these efforts? Mm-hmm. And what sort of frameworks do you think about?
Yeah, well, so philosophers are good at making distinctions. We're good at asking precise questions, less good at coming up with correct answers. And so I'm going to give you a distinction. A distinction that I think is important as a way of... As opposed to an answer. But philosophers also will say, I will say, a question well asked is already half answered. So I'm getting you half an answer.
I've heard that from school.
That was true in mathematics. So, <yeah. No.
laughs> Right, a well-framed answer is obvious. Exactly. A well-framed question is answer is obvious.
It's true in philosophy.
Yeah.
All right, so here's the distinction.
It's true in math.
So take where we began. AI is a tool, and you gave all of these potential applications that would seem to be beneficial and actually are happening. So the first thing is just to acknowledge head on here that, putting it really kind of grandly, the mindset of a technologist, the mindset of an AI scientist, the mindset of an engineer is a maximizer, an optimizer, someone who wants to deliver efficiency to the world. And efficiency, maximizing, and optimization are derivative values. They are not first order good things. They're derivative. By that I mean efficiency, optimizing and maximizing is only good if it's independently attached to something else that is good. If we are making something bad in the world, we're producing it more efficiently. The fact that we're doing that efficiently makes the world worse, not better. That's what I mean by the fact that efficiency is a derivative value.
So is efficiency a bad metric? Is that what you're saying?
Efficiency is a bad metric unless we are confident that we have independently evaluated the worthiness of the end to which we want to be more efficient. So that's where it takes the mindset of a technologist not to be hyper-obsessed with efficiency alone, but to understand the end to which he or she wishes to be more efficient. Here's the overworked philosophical way of putting this in a perhaps unappealing way, just to drive the point home. Engineers were responsible for constructing the gas chambers in Nazi-era Germany. They are super efficient mechanisms for killing people. It would have been better for the world if there were less efficient engineers in Nazi Germany. If you choose to deploy your optimizing mindset to an objectively bad end, you are doing something bad for the world. Okay, so all of the action, I want to say, initially is choosing a good end. So now we come up with the use cases. Let's not talk about just applying the tool. We have to know, is the end to which we're applying it something worthwhile, independently worthwhile? And then we have social discussion. People can disagree over whether or not the AI whispering in your ear, that's Sally whom you met 3 weeks ago, is on balance something that's improving human welfare or maybe has unintended consequences. And I don't have anything final to say about, let me give you the roster of the good things and a roster of the bad things. My point is that as AI has become as powerful as it is, and it only promises to become more powerful, the ends to which we put it are going to have multiple different values about which there will likely be some social disagreement. And relying on the AI scientist alone or the company alone to decide for us what counts as good is not a recipe for delivering good outcomes.
So I've heard this a lot in mathematics and computer science as well, is that, you know, be very careful the questions you ask. Right, and is that question aligned with the outcome that you're looking for?
Right.
And I think you just also were, were saying that as you're evaluating these questions, you need sort of a diverse look at this, not just one perspective from the actual AI engineer.
Can I add one more layer, or should
I want to get to one more.
Well, let me jump in with this because I find that such a good point that you're making. Of course, When we're talking to people in the field, they often say, but look, I'm just doing what my boss tells me to do, right? And but what I always think is that as an engineer, as a mathematician or a statistician or a computer scientist, you really do need to understand these larger, broader questions as well. And in the fall quarter, I had this small class in ESF. You know, you were part of that too. It's a really interesting fall quarter series for first year students. And mine was themed unintended consequences, where we look at unintended consequences, both positive and negative, of technology developments, and the AI came up, of course, a lot. Mm-hmm. And I think just as a practitioner or somebody interested in studying this, to understand a bit more about the wider perspective in which these problems are solved and are used in companies or in academia is so incredibly important. But your question or your question, say the end needs to be good. That I'm so glad I'm in mathematics, because for us the end is good when we prove a theorem, and that makes and it's beautiful and it makes life so much easier for me.
So I guess, Margo, you're saying that once we ask the right question, were you pushing out that we also need to understand how these algorithms are actually answering that question?
Well, absolutely, of course. But what I find is that if you have somebody, and I was the same, I was a ballistic mathematics student, so to say. So I went into my undergrad, I just studied math and computer science and physics. And I didn't study philosophy. I didn't study ethics. I did not really know about moral frameworks. So it was really, really difficult for me. I didn't know about human behavior or the social sciences, humanities. I really knew very little. I know much more now, ever since I came to Stanford, saying, okay, there's much more in the world that I need to know. But at that time, when I didn't understand this, I didn't even question what I was doing. And that is what I see so very often in the field of not just AI, but in math and computer science and statistics, engineering in general, is that people just do it for the love of solving a problem without having any idea of what this actually will contribute in what way.
So I think what you're both pushing for is that now, because of how powerful these tools are as a tool of thought, one of the first tools of we've done as a society, as you actually do this and you deploy that technology, you got to think about, who are the diverse thoughts that you're going to bring to actually deployment of this? Can you think about this from an ethical perspective, from a privacy perspective, and so forth? But also know that your point of view is not necessarily correct. Almost you have to assume your point of view has flaws.
You need a much wider perspective.
And to do critical thinking, have a wider perspective.
And for that, you need people around you, like Rob and others, who can point it out to you. But you also really need to study this yourself. So that would be my big call to everybody here. Study more than just the algorithms. And the reason why it's so incredibly important now is that many, many decisions in the world now are based on AI or data science algorithms, right?
And Margo, sitting next to you, Sharad, you were talking about just recently, I think, the EdgeGuide conference. We have algorithms who can say, I know how to make a fair algorithm. And if you look at the research community, they have three approaches to fairness. And you came out and you said very boldly, they're kind of wrong. And there's many subtleties where we try from a mathematical perspective to have a fair algorithm. And we do the fair algorithm, we think we're involving the right people. And you came out and said, well, guys, you're missing it, because even if you follow these methods of fairness, you're going to have unintended consequences. Can you tell me a little bit more about that for the audience? And then we'll break for some questions from the audience.
Yeah, I think I'm more of a failed mathematician compared to Margo. I started out as a mathematician, but then realized I couldn't really do it that well.
But that's because you went to really hard problems. I just stayed with the easy stuff.
So now I just like spend my time making fun of mathematicians. And so this is my, the 2-minute version or the 1-minute version of what Scott was referring to is, I think there's this push in computer science to formalize and to formalize these big ideas like fairness, to mathematically formalize these ideas. And I think there's something conceptually useful to forcing ourselves to think in a precise manner, but also a topic that's as big as fairness, to codify that into a simple definition, you already know that's not possible. It's just not gonna work out. But what's happened in the computer science community, and now there've been hundreds, if not thousands of papers written in this vein of, here's my favorite mathematical definition of fairness, and now I'm gonna optimize, very efficiently solve this particular problem, and then put it out there. And one of the things that I see, and so this is, we're, computer science are really good at this. You can definitely like write a paper if you're interested in this sort of thing. You just like write down your favorite definition, you optimize against that, and now this is your like fair algorithm. The problem is, what does that really mean? Is it good? It's fast. I mean, these are what we're trying to do. We're making these things very fast. But is it useful in a broad sense? And I think one of the problems, and so the work that, that I did was showing that very broadly, there are these like three categories of fairness, and we're saying that none of them actually make that much conceptual sense. And this is like a pretty, you know, it's a controversial view. I think it's right, most people don't, so I'm just putting that out there. But I think we need to step back and really think about what the implications of these algorithms are when we deploy them, and not in, and get out of this mathematical way, or exclusively mathematical way of thinking about fairness.
So interesting. So it's almost like what we've heard here is that even a purely mathematical approach to AI is insufficient.
Yeah, I mean, I think not only is it insufficient, I don't think of it, I think of it as a useful component, but not the central perspective that one should take. So it's not like mathematics plus a little bit of, you know, philosophy thrown in. I would flip it. And so this is like a very hard message for technically trained people, including myself, to hear is like, yes, we, it's AI, we should be involved. It's not clear that we should actually be the central players in deciding how these systems should be designed and deployed and evaluating the ethics of them.
Can I ask, because I just want to, I think I'm following you exactly, but I just want to make sure. So three different ways to operationalize fairness computationally. But you know they don't work, or their intention, whatever it may be. I don't want the implication of that to be fairness is just a subjective view.
Exactly. Yeah.
Whatever Sherrod thinks fairness is fine. Whatever Margo thinks is fine. Yeah. Wait, like get your definition of fairness up and running and just have at it. Yeah. That sounds like moral relativism and disaster.
Yeah.
But there's no single correct answer either. There are better and worse definitions.
Yeah.
And then the question is, how do we choose among them?
Yeah. I wish I could take you on the road with me to help make my case. I think that's exactly right. And there's this relatively well-known result in computer science now that it's mathematically impossible to simultaneously satisfy these various definitions of fairness that have been proposed. It's true. It's a mathematically true result. I think it is highly misleading exactly for this reason, that because of this, people are like, oh, look, you can't have all this stuff, so let's just do whatever we want to do. And it's like, no, that's not at all what it's saying. It's saying, none of these three things that are quite popular, we don't care for any of them. So the fact that we can't have all three of them at the same time, that's actually totally fine.
Is there some sort of like Heisenberg principle in AI, in a sense that you try to understand what it is, and the more you look at it from one dimension, the farther off you get from the correct answer?
It might be a little early in the day for Heisenberg principle for me, but
I'm thinking about this, you know, as a mathematician, I like, you know, nice concise answers. And what I'm hearing from you is that's not going to cut it. And I'm hearing from you is that you're way far off in terms of you got to think about personal ethics and social ethics and whatnot.
Right.
So how would, for the audience in here, as they are intending to go forth into industry and academia, and I think many people want to do good in their AI, what would be your advice? Now, how do they then proceed, you know, in advancing research and advancing their agenda of having positive impact? Mm-hmm. What would you give them from your perspective on making sure that what they intend actually occurs?
Well, I think this will be shared by both of you. I mean, we're here at a university, and so my first inclination is to say something totally unsexy and uninteresting, which is that the benefit of a liberal arts education at a place like this university, where you don't just do technical work, but you're deliberately engaged with the work of social scientists and humanists, is one way to begin to approach these questions. You know, Mark, you said before, the one thing I bristled at is like, I didn't study philosophy, I didn't care about philosophy, ethics, morals, and I think every human being has to confront moral and ethical questions about how they live their own lives.
I changed my life. I'm okay now.
You saw the light or something. Right.
So as an individual, if I'm listening to you, and let's say I'm in love with mathematics, or I'm in love with physics or whatnot, you're saying that for me to do a better job, I need to think about also the liberal arts passion and start to use the creative mind of being a human and explore that more to help me get off my pedestal in terms of my particular area of interest.
You might ask yourself better questions. You might give yourself a different and better objective function to solve for. And you might also be able to give our expression to or articulate better the array of different valuable things in the world that your own particular technical approach has implications for, rather than just the head down, you know, do what the boss tells you, hit your targets, and then call it a day and go home and
have dinner. So future leaders are almost like Renaissance people in some sense.
Sure.
Okay.
Would be
so it's
great
like a new renaissance of leadership.
Yes.
Right? So, I mean, Sharad, you're smiling. I mean, what do you think about that in terms of the recommendations to moving beyond Heisenberg principle?
Behind Heisenberg. I think being humble is very, very important in this area. And I think it's extremely hard to do, even like I'm not a humble person. So I know this is like it's a difficult thing. And it's like, I keep on coming back to the fact that once we know this technical material, it's so easy to think that we can do everything. And moving out of that mindset, when you interact with policymakers, practitioners who can't do this technical stuff, they can't build the algorithms, they can't do what we are providing, but we have to step back from that and really realize that, yeah, we can do this thing, but that's not necessarily what's in their best interest or in society's best interest, or that we have all the answers, even though we can do this thing that essentially no one else in the world can do. It's like once you can do that, like right now we're in this privileged place where it feels like, you know, 99.9% of the world can't do what we can do. The world is going to catch up, and I think this is going to be a very good thing, and this will become trivial. I mean, basically, I see like high school students are fitting, you know, these deep neural nets now, and that's, you know, in some ways, I'm a little bit scared, but, you know, in some ways, this is like good because we realize it's actually
trivial. It's TensorFlow.js, right? It works,
what?
Right? Yeah, it's two lines in JavaScript.
I know, exactly. Right. And so it's like, once we realize that, it's like you have to think about the hard problems now. It's like not the easy problem of like, I can fit this model, but the hard problem of what model are you actually building and what is the application and what are you doing about it?
So it sounds like you sort of agree, the sense of the multidimensionality of the mind, and how do you then think about liberal arts and that, not just your particular study, but how do you have a broad perspective, and then bringing other people to help you.
Yeah, I think bringing other people, I think this is super important, that it's not, I don't think it's possible for one person to really do this type of work.
And so AI is a team sport then?
Yeah, and it's not even AI. I think this is actually part of the issue that we think of it is, how are we going to do AI for good? It's not how are we going to do AI for good, it's like how are we going to do good? And one thing that we're bringing to the table is AI, it's like, great, that's fine. And it's like, this is
this is about doing good in general.
Yeah, and it's like, you're not gonna say, we're gonna do good, so let's get the computer scientists in the room. No one is gonna say that. But once you say, let's do AI for good.
Well, we say that a lot.
It's like, but once you say AI for good, all of a sudden, it's only computer scientists. And this is like a very funny perspective that I think is really an artifact of the language. The fact that we say AI for good automatically
for
excludes, or it makes the conversation about AI, when really I think it's about doing good.
Yeah, so Margot, I'm leaving with the last word, then we'll break for a few minutes of questions.
Yeah.
But as a former leader of ICME, what advice would you give this crowd in terms of what's the one thing they could do to...
Well, apart really from what Rob says, I'm a big believer in holistic education. And you have no excuse when you're here on campus. Every single day there are interesting talks, and you can go to courses and take courses in all sorts of areas. So it's wonderful. It changed me, for sure. The other thing I would just want to say, slow down. One of the things that I see with so many is everybody's so eager to try these new powerful tools on whatever type of problem they can lay their hands on. And they publish without thinking, they publish without really testing. And they're so eager to get those results out and run this fast train, and they don't slow down and really think about, what does this mean? Is this even useful? Should I be publishing it? Should I be working on this area? And talk to other people and get their perspectives on what you're doing.
Good. So when in a rush, slow down.
That's right.
So with that, we've got, how much time do we actually have left? -3 minutes? So if there are any brave souls, we have, you know, a wonderful set of perspectives up here, from public policy to fundamental science, and as well as ethics and economic structures. A question? So how effective is it to bring in people who are not necessarily engineers to talk about these issues? I think we're still at Aspen Ideas, which we've been doing there, fantastic work, and maybe some insights you have from that.
Well, I myself haven't worked in a big company, so I can't give you, through my own experience, an answer to the question of whether it's a good idea, a bad idea, or how to do it well to bring in the product manager to talk to the development team about whatever the ethical questions are. Maybe you can say something about that, Scott.
Sure.
But apropos the basic note that we struck here, While it's true that we can have a division of labor, both within the academy and within companies about people who do things, the ethics questions, it seems to me, everyone should have some legitimate place at the table to weigh in on. There's no ethics expert who comes in for, you have legal compliance and then you get ethics compliance within the company and you get the check marks about whether or not you've complied with your ethical principles and the ethics expert or ethics team has weighed in. That seems to me an unwise way of thinking about this. You want to bake it into the development of whatever product from the start with a set of design principles that don't deliver uniquely correct answers, but are going to be a product of debate that even people outside the company might have some legitimate say in helping inform your own decision making.
I think that's spot on from what I've seen, and also in our own company, where now it's baked into the process of should even do this research, and if once you do the research, should even build the product. And then the product goes out, you start thinking about what are the implications of this for privacy and whatnot.
Right.
And you think through the whole process. This has really changed how we think about products. So I agree with you. Another question?
Maybe I can ask one comment
that piggybacks on this. There are all these groups and these companies that have FairML, FairAI groups, and they're relatively small. And what I think is funny is like you have like this, 100,000 people at the company, 50,000 ML people who are doing not FairML, and then like 10 people are doing FairML, and you're like, what are the other people doing? So this is I think is very much the sense that can't be
it's
the FairML
in the
people
society, right?
And then the ML people, because the implication is the ML people are just trying to make money and the FairML people
it's baked in.
Yeah,
what you
exactly.
Do.
So right. I don't want to be too glib about it. I think it's useful that these groups exist. And I do think there's a value to thinking spending all of your time thinking about these issues rather than groups that are thinking about other things part of the time. But I do think it has to be baked into the fundamentals. Of
okay. And what Rob was saying, that it has to be done right from the very start when you first start formulating the questions that you want to answer or the products that you want to make. And very often it's an afterthought the good people come in to try to correct the stuff that these others have done. Yeah. Right.
I saw about 30 hands. So we're going to in the red in the middle. Sharad, you already brought that up.
Yeah.
So the question is, if you can't use mathematics and the rigor of mathematics, do you just use your gut? I mean, what's the mechanism you use to have a good judgment and know you're correct?
Yeah, I mean, I would say...
Is that a good summary? Okay.
The reality is we use our gut for essentially every decision we've ever made in our entire life. And so it's not just our gut. This is like, I think this is a good thing to keep in mind, that very, very few decisions, has anyone actually made like a mathematically informed, important life decision. It's like I teach a cost-benefit analysis, but when I'm trying to decide what job to take, I don't actually like write out the table and like write the numbers and then like add things
42.
Up.
I had
to fail that mathematician. That's why.
This shows the difference.
So
it's an optimization curve.
Other than Margo. So it's very hard, but I think the spirit of the question is exactly right, that there is this middle ground between anything goes, I'm just going to use my gut and I don't have to justify it to anybody, versus a strict formalism, which I think generally is also inappropriate, of structured reasoning, persuasion. It's very close to how we make any kind of democratic decision. You have to go out there, you have to make your case, you have to persuade people, you have to get reactions, and that's how I think we have to make
which
all
goes
these
back
types
to being
of,
human, right?
of high
having
stakes decisions. So and again, this is hard. We're engineers, many of us are engineers.
So I'm getting the hook right now.
Sorry.
So I think what I'd like to do
is play the music.
Yeah, exactly. Play the music. So in the seminar series, we'll be bringing through leaders in academia and in industry and be talking about what they're doing in AI for good. And I encourage you to think through to the perspective you saw today. Think through your personal ethics, your professional ethics and society ethics as you're listening to her talk. Also to think about the frameworks that they're using. Are they looking at this purely from a mathematical perspective? Or are they thinking about more broadly the different disciplines you need to make the right decision? And finally, are they understanding the models they're using, and are they using AI just to use AI, or is it the appropriate tool? Mm-hmm. So thank you very much. I think you have a couple minutes on...
Just read the slide.
Read the slide, okay. Thank you very much.